First of all, welcome to our service here, our Easter Resurrection Sunday service at Aberdeen Baptist Church. Glad to have you here. And we're just kind of trying out new things. But first, we're trying Zoom here, several locations. I would ask if you could mute your sound. Those that are on Zoom, if you could mute your sound right now, and that would be greatly appreciated. Well, we're just going to block out a bit of sun here. This sun is, we were told there's going to be 75% chance of rain about a week ago, and you plan accordingly, and isn't it beautiful weather? And so we're going to have to have more faith or something, but it's good to see the nice weather, and I wish we would have planned for nice weather. Anyway, glad to have you here. We're going to have a time of rejoicing and singing, and of course, this is Easter Resurrection Sunday, and remember the time when Jesus rose from the grave. The stone was rolled away, not to let Jesus out, but to let other people in to see he's risen. And so this is the time, especially in our Christian faith, we rejoice. It's a time when Jesus, he not only died on the cross for our sins, but he rose on the third day, and we remember that. We're going to sing our first song here, and that is Hosanna. And so let's sing that song, Hosanna. Those that are in your homes or whatever, just feel free to sing right along that song, Hosanna. Song we're going to sing is Hope of the Nations. Jesus, Hope of the Nations. Jesus, Comfort for all who mourn.
You are the source of heaven's light on earth.
Song, He Lives, and Jesus Lives, and I trust he's into our hearts today. So let's sing that song, He Lives. I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. There's something here that says announcements here, and I think I have one announcement. Today is Derek and Sarah's 6th anniversary. And so let's all sing Happy Anniversary. That song, it will mess up, I know, but at least the thought is there. Happy Anniversary to you. Had a joy having them in our church for many years, and we're going to call on Sarah. She's going to be playing a flute solo. Appreciate it when she comes and plays for us, and she's going to do a great job. So let's listen to Sarah as she sings, as she plays this song. It is Because He Lives. Thank you so much, Sarah. I just really appreciate your plan and your ministry in a church, your family, and of course, expecting another member within 2 or 3 weeks, I believe. 2 weeks, okay. So we'll be praying for the Waltons and the new baby that's coming along. So that's wonderful to see some a new person in the church. Well, John's been speaking with us for the past few weeks anyway, and so we appreciate the word that he gives. And so I'm going to call on John right now. I don't have a... Oh, excuse me, did I forget something? No. So I'm going to call on John right now, and I don't have a story about him, unfortunately, but I'll think maybe one for after. No, I don't have a story. Okay, John, Lord bless you.
Thank you, Wayne. And thank you, Sarah, for that flute solo. It reminded me of the time when I was a young boy and played in the Cloverdale Junior High School band. And it goes back some time, and it's always nice to hear the flute played with such skill. And thank you, enjoyed that, and especially, you know, what a joy it is to hold a newborn baby. I can understand why that song is pretty special as well, especially in light of Easter Day. And as we think about the wonder of Christ living, it's wonderful that we can come together in this way. So for those that are on Zoom land, hello. Nice to see you all virtually. I'm kind of looking at the back of the computer, but by faith, I believe you're on the other side. So it's good to be together. Especially today, it's the Lord's Day, but it's the day in which we celebrate the Lord's resurrection. And if you think about it, as Christians, we celebrate the new creation, and we are continually reminded when we come together to worship on Sunday, the first day of the week, that we are recognizing the fact that this is the day that Jesus rose from the grave. And so that is the prime reason why we gather on this day. I would like us, if we could, please, to turn to the scriptures, to John chapter 20. I want to read the whole chapter of scripture. This morning we will be reading a considerable amount of scripture. The scriptures exhort us to give attention to the public reading of scripture. This is how the word also was communicated in the Old Testament, when people would gather together and the law was read. And so it's a good practice. It should always be a part of a worship service and a very big part of the worship service. It's too easy to be in a hurry and simply read from snippets of scripture, but it's always good to read context and to be instructed by the word of God. John chapter 20. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark, and saw the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going towards the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stopped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one on the head and the other at the feet. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced this to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my fingers into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these things are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Father, we just ask as we come into your word this morning that you'd help us listen to what your Spirit is saying to the churches. These scriptures are given for our instruction, for us being built up in our faith, and for the opportunity to proclaim the gospel to those round about us and to herald forth the name of Jesus in this world. So help us to be attentive, encourage your people, as, Lord, there are many things that distract us and take us away from focusing upon you. We thank you for the opportunity it is ours to come together in this way, and help us, Lord, in what we do today, that your name would be glorified and that everything is said and done, Lord, would be honoring to your name, for it is your resurrection, Jesus, that we celebrate today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. This morning, I want to build our message around the eyewitness account of the disciples who testified to a skeptical Thomas in John 20 and 25, "We have seen the Lord." The word seen literally means to see or to attend to perceive or to look upon with focus. The idea is clearly expressed in 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 to 3, where John writes, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. This life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you also, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ." Now, John is, of course, writing this letter with the backdrop of those Gnostics who denied that Jesus actually had a physical body. So it was very important for John to speak that way. But when the disciples looked upon Jesus, they saw him physically as their resurrected Lord. For the disciples to say that they had a visible post-burial encounter with Jesus, humanly speaking, is an unbelievable, mind-stretching claim for anyone to digest, given what had happened to all of Jesus' followers and what they had experienced over the last few days. It was very discouraging. Had not the followers of Jesus witnessed the death of Christ for themselves? Were the disciples not aware that Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council and yet a secret disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jewish religious leaders, that Joseph of Arimathea, with Pilate's permission, had taken our Lord's deceased body down from the cross, bound it with linen and spices, along with Nicodemus, remember him, and buried him in his own garden tomb, which he had recently cut out of the rock near the place where Jesus was crucified. And in Luke 24, we read about the women who had come with Jesus from Galilee. They followed and saw the tomb and how the body was laid. I can imagine Thomas thinking, why are these guys messing with my head? When you're dead, you're dead. What is there not to understand about that phrase? And yet Thomas had forgotten how Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. In John 11, verse 16, cynical Thomas said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go along that we may die with him," after he learned from Jesus that Lazarus had physically died. The sun could be shining, but Thomas would see the only cloud in the sky. Instead of a glass being half full for Thomas, it was always half empty or simply just empty. And so in response to the disciples' testimony, Thomas curtly responds with a Missouri show me state, as is known, comment. Of course, Thomas invented that statement before Missouri ever came along, which of course is used on all of the Missouri license plate, show me state. It's an interesting comment or phrase, especially because they have to see before they believe. In verse 25, Thomas abruptly, emphatically responds, "Unless," or as the King James says, "except I see his hands, the mark of the nails, and the place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will never," or "I will refuse," as one translation puts it, "to believe." Well, It's pretty strong emotive language coming from Thomas's lips here. I mean, he dug in his heels. There's no way troubled Thomas was going to be hurt or hoodwinked or taken down the garden path again with what he perceived to be an empty promise and dashed hopes in Jesus as the promised Messiah. In his discussion with Jesus in Luke 24, Cleopas, whom he and a fellow Jesus follower did not recognize when Jesus showed up, summed up things this way when they had this conversation with Jesus on the Emmaus Road. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things have happened. So you see the discouragement that was pervading the followers of Christ. The death of Jesus on the cross put an end to all of that. Having the Missouri spirit, Thomas responded to his fellow disciples' claim that they had seen the Lord by simply saying, "Show me the mark of nails in his hands, so I can place my finger into that mark and place my hands into his side." And because of this cynical skepticism, the phrase doubting Thomas is used widely to describe those who refuse to believe without having direct personal experience. But before we are too hard on Thomas, let us remember that he was not the only one who was disillusioned and did not understand Jesus' promise that he would rise again from the dead. We read about this in Luke chapter 24, where Luke pens these words, "But on the first day of the week, at the early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared," talking about the Marys, "and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he told you that while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise?' And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, and stooping and looking, he saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened." Peter marveled, but still wasn't sure, or still wasn't convinced, because we see that in Peter's responses down the road. And then there was the story that took place on the Emmaus Road, where Jesus covertly walked along the road with two of his disciples. And we read from Luke 24 that very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all of these things that had happened. And while they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here these last few days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty indeed, and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and the rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." Yes, and besides all of this, it is now the third day since these things have happened. "Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and they did not find his body. And they came back saying that they had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. And some of those who were with us went out to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him. And he said, 'O foolish ones, and slow to heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that Christ should suffer these things and enter into glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to where they were going, and he acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is now far spent.' So he went to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to each other, 'Did not our hearts burn within us when he talked to us on the road while he opened the scriptures?' And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were gathered together, saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread." What a wonderful story. It's very difficult to actually read that story without having some emotional triggers go off, at least in my own heart, in my own mind, because of the drama of it. They all of a sudden met Jesus face to face, who they thought was dead, and now he was alive. In Mark's Act chapter 16, we read this: "And now when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out seven demons. And she went and told those who had been with him that as they mourned and wept, but when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they would not believe it. After these things, he appeared in another form to two of them as they were walking into the country. And they went back and told the rest, but they did not believe them." And of course, then over in our context of John chapter 20, 24 and 25, we read this: "And on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for the fear of the Jews, specifically the religious leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and side. Then the disciples were glad." Now, as I read that word glad, I think it's too soft of a word. Other translations have it this way: "The disciples rejoiced." The disciples were filled with joy. Or yet another translation, they were overjoyed. And I think that better fits the context of the scripture, of the kind of emotion response that the disciples had to actually behold their risen Savior when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." The fearful, disillusioned, confused, troubled disciples were in the midst of a great lockdown, not because of COVID, but for fear of the Jews on the evening of the first day of the week. And just as Jesus had vanished from those he spoke with on the Emmaus road, he appeared behind closed doors to meet with his disciples, comforting them with that common Hebrew greeting, "Peace be with you," as he showed them his hands and his side. Luke 24, verses 38, 43 tells us that the disciples were startled and frightened that they saw a spirit when Jesus entered the room unannounced. And Jesus asked, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your heart? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, it's an interesting phrase, while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, it's kind of like a pinch me now moment. It's kind of like when I remember our first child being born and I was driving down the Drumheller Hill from Munson, Alberta. And I was saying to myself, I am a father. It's like I had to convince myself that I was a father for the first time. And I remember becoming quite emotional, and my car windows were rolled up, so I could have cared less who ever heard me outside the car. Of course, they couldn't. But I was just screaming to the top of my voice, "I'm a dad!" I still remember that experience like it was yesterday. And the disciples could hardly believe what they were witnessing with their eyes. And they were marveling. And Jesus said, "Have you anything to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broilfish, and he took it and ate it before them. And John tells us in John 20:20, after coming face to face with reality, that Jesus indeed had been physically raised from the dead. And the disciples were overjoyed. But there was one problem. Where's Thomas? He's not here. Skeptical Thomas was somewhere else. And when the disciples told Thomas they saw the Lord, as we have noted, he refused to believe the eyewitness encounters of the apostles, even being outnumbered 10 to 1. I mean, if you had 10 people coming around to you and saying, "Look, Jesus rose from the grave," what would you think? How would you respond? Would you question? Would you think, well, these guys, they've had too much sunshine or something, because it's not making sense to me, because I knew what happened to Jesus, and I'm just not going to believe this witness that they are telling me, that they've lost it. They're having a breakdown. That's how bad it is for them. I can imagine Thomas thinking that way. But 8 days later, we read in John 20:25, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked again, Jesus came and stood among them and said again, "Peace be with you." That word peace is a wonderful word in the Christian vernacular, because it reminds us of the peace that we have with God through faith in Christ, as we read about in Romans 5:1. And it also talks about how the Christian community is called to peace within the fellowship. There's so many things that we could speak about on that word, this common Hebrew greeting. But why did Jesus wait 8 days? Seems like a delay. Like delaying and seeing sick Lazarus. The Lord had his reasons for Lazarus. It was that his glory might be revealed through the resurrection of Lazarus. In our text, we are not told the reason Jesus visited 8 days later, but it must have been a long, hard week for Thomas, wrestling with the eyewitness testimony of 10 of his close fellow disciples. And then in this conversation, Jesus addresses doubting Thomas. And I believe in a pastoral sense, not in a harsh way, but in a pastoral sense. And it's important to understand that our Lord is aware of our infirmities, as it says in Hebrews 4 and 15. That sometimes we feel so unworthy and we've messed up and blown it and we've done dumb things and we've denied the faith in one way, or we have doubted the things that Christ has taught. And he comes to us and he says, "My child." As he says to Thomas, he as he showed him his hands and his side, as he had done for the other disciples in a previous visit. And Jesus exhorts Thomas not to disbelieve, but to believe. Because in this case, with Thomas, seeing is believing, right? The Berean Study Bible translates it this way: stop doubting and believe. And Thomas responds with humble worship, saying to Jesus, my Lord and my God. It is more than a mere expression of speech like, oh my God, which I have heard desperate Jehovah Witnesses say when arguing against this clear confession of our Lord's deity. That's how some take that to mean, but it's not that. It's a statement of deity. The Reformed Study Bible comments this way: this probably is the clearest and simplest confession of deity to be found in the New Testament. Jesus accepts this worship without hesitation, which is in sharp contrast to the angels who immediately refused when John mistakenly began to worship them. Jesus is greater than the angels, as we read in Hebrews 1. In Revelation 19, verses 9 and 10, the angel said to me, John, write this: blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Then I fell down to his feet to worship him. And he said to me, you must not do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And so we see that Thomas not only worshiped Jesus as his Lord and God, but Jesus accepted the worship, which reminds us of the statement he made to the Jewish leaders in John when he said, I am before Abraham, referring to his eternity and his oneness with God and his position in the Godhead. I want us to grasp this morning the sense of awe and the raw emotion for the disciples and the company when it finally sunk in that death could not keep Jesus down, that he was the victor over the grave, and that Jesus, as Paul said in Romans 1:4, was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. It is gripping. It has impact. It is life-changing to the point that all of these disciples were willing to die a martyr's death along with many other saints for the cause of their beloved Savior. C.T. Studd, missionary to China, India, and Africa, said this: if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, then no scarce can be too great, or no sacrifice can be too great for me to make for him. I'm reminded of the story of Jacob's son. Remember that story, telling their dad that this very hard to fathom story that Joseph was still alive and ruler over all of the land of Egypt? Oh, I mean, it kind of reminds me a little bit about the disciples telling Thomas that we have seen the Lord. What are you talking about? Genesis 45, it tells us that Jacob's heart became numb, for he did not believe them. I mean, for 22 some years, Jacob had lived under the false impression that Joseph had been devoured by a fierce animal. And we read in Genesis 37, when he heard the news about the supposed death of Joseph, that Jacob tore his garments, put his sackcloth on his loins, and mourned for his son many days. And all of his sons and all of his daughters rose up to comfort him. But he refused to be comforted and said, no, I shall go down to Sheol to my son mourning. And thus his father wept for him. Oh, the pain of tragedy that happens within a family, like Jacob experienced. And I think about those right now who are suffering. Their children are at the verge of dying, or they've lost loved ones, or sisters or brothers are very sick, and they don't have long for this world. It's a difficult time to go through. But over to Genesis 45, when they told Joseph, or told Jacob, all the words of Joseph, which he had said to them, and when they saw the wagons and that Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of their father Jacob revived. And Israel said, "It is enough. Joseph, my son, is still alive, and I will go and see him before I die." Now, I cannot read through the story of Joseph in Egypt and how his father ended up coming down to be reunited with him without becoming very emotional, without shedding a tear, to see the providence of God and the plan of God behind the whole thing and this reuniting. What a wonderful event. It kind of reminds me when soldiers come home from the battlefield and they have a surprise revealed to their family that they are home, and the little children come running up saying, "Daddy, Daddy, Daddy." I mean, this was so wonderful. And then there are the words of the two followers of Jesus on the road to Emmaus, which we've read, when Jesus broke the bread and blessed it, and he broke it and gave it to them, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight, and they said to one another, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened the scriptures?" I mean, you read through all of the things that Jesus has taught and what he has said. This is his story. It's about him. And this is what Easter Sunday is about. It's not about us. It's about Jesus as we celebrate what he revealed to the disciples on the road to Emmaus, and how he opened the scriptures, and how they all point to the Lord Jesus Christ in the fulfillment of prophecy. It's an amazing thing. Matthew 28, Mary Magdalene, the other Mary, hearing that Jesus had been raised from the grave, departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, ran to tell his disciples. Behold, Jesus met them, saying, "Greetings," and they came up, and they took hold of his feet, and they worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Oh, this was just, the minds of the followers of Christ were just whirling. They were so excited to see Jesus alive. One of my favorite Easter songs is by Don Francisco, and called "He's Alive." And he sings about what Peter must have felt like through the dark hours of Jesus' crucifixion. The gates and the doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow, half in fear the day would find the soldiers crashing through to drag us all away. And just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down to the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said, "They moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there." We both ran towards the garden, and Jesus ran on ahead. We found the stone, the empty tomb, just the way that Mary had said. The winding sheet that wrapped him in was just an empty shell, and how or why they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Something strange had happened there, but I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstances and speculation couldn't lift me very high, because I'd seen them crucify him, and then I'd watched him die. Back inside the house again, all the guilt and anguish came. Everything I promised him just added to my shame. But at last it came to choices. I denied I knew his name. Even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. But suddenly the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide, and I fell down on my knees and clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out of them like sunlight from the sky. Guilt and my confusion disappeared into sweet release. Every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. Luke writes in Acts 1, he says, in the first book, O Theophilus, have I dealt with all the things that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands to the Holy Spirit to the apostles to whom he had chosen. And he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during the 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. In Acts 2 and 32, Peter preaches this Jesus God raised up, and that of which we are all witnesses. Paul preaches to the Corinthians, and he says, now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance that what I received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scripture, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and to the 12, and then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, and then to all the apostles, and last of all, as one untimely born, he appeared to me. So in conclusion, for the Christian, every day is Resurrection Sunday. John Calvin said, the resurrection of Christ is the most important article of our faith, and without it, the hope of eternal life is extinguished. Vaudi Bachman says, we are always resurrection-centered. If we are not resurrection-centered, then we are not gospel-centered. John Knox says, by God's grace I declare Jesus Christ, the strength of his death and the power of his resurrection. And Wolfhart Pannenberg states this, the evidence for Jesus' resurrection is so strong that nobody would question it except for two things. First, it is a very unusual event. And secondly, if you believe it happened, you have to change the way you live. And this is what Jesus called us to. He said, Jesus said to him, to Thomas, you have believed because you have seen me. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed. Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Jesus lives. Father, take this word, throw away the chaff, and challenge us with this wonderful event that took place some 2,000 years ago with your rising from the dead. Oh, Lord, may it grip our hearts to understand that our hope is not resting in just wishful thinking, but by the authority of your word and in the powerful resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it's because he has been raised from the dead that we can trust him and look forward one day to seeing him come back. We pray that all of our hearts together might be encouraged with the fact that Jesus has been raised from the dead. Amen.
Thank you very much, John. Appreciate the word from your heart, and it's touched us all, I'm sure, and just what Jesus did for us. And that song, actually, He's Alive, that's Don Francisco, that's a favorite of Suzanne and mine as well. Just a wonderful, powerful song. Well, we're going to sing a song, and after that, I'm going to call on John to lead us in a communion service. And the song we're going to sing is Christ Arose. Christ arose, low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord, and then up from the grave. And that's, we serve a risen Savior, which reminds me of another song. But we're going to sing this song here today. Christ arose.
Low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he rose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose the victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Vainly they watch his bed, Jesus, my Savior. Vainly they seal the dead, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose the victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Death cannot keep his prey, Jesus, my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the he arose the victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose.
Amen. We're going to call on Brother John here to lead us in our communion service, and I'll leave that with him. It's kind of new for a lot of us, this situation, but Brother John.
This is a different way to go about communion, but we do have a few people here that are helping us put together the service this morning online, and so we will be distributing the elements to one another as part of what we are doing. But before we do that, I want to just share some thoughts from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, which, of course, is a go-to passage that often is read at communion services. Starting at verse 17, I want to read down through to the end of the chapter. In the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. For there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. When you come together, it's not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in the eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry and another gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat in and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you? No, I will not. And then Paul gives a corrective. He says, for I received from the Lord what also I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then. And so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. About the other things, I will give directions when I come. Just a few thoughts here. Communion is at the heart of church fellowship. The early church partook weekly, coupled with what was known as their love feast. As Christ followers who gather around the Lord's table, and it's the Lord's table, and we want to underline that, it's not our table, it doesn't belong to the church, it's the Lord's table. We're reminded of the broken body of Christ and his shed blood by which we have been redeemed and through which we are called his own. We look back to the future, actually. Because Jesus taught us, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, looking back to the work of Christ on the cross for us, you proclaim, and so there's a witness that takes place, and this is what we are doing today by partaking, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So we look back to the future. We do everything here in anticipation of that wonderful, glorious truth that Jesus is coming again. And so our text here is corrective in nature because the Corinthians were behaving badly. He could not commend them because their gatherings revealed their divisions, their factions, their childishness, their impatience, and even drunkenness, which all summed up in one word is simply carnality, which was a problem, of course, that Paul had to deal with the Corinthians in their own fellowship. Their conduct, the way they behaved between each other, contradicted the very intent of what the Lord's table was to be about. The Lord's table is about Jesus Christ, his death on the cross, and how this is to govern our relationships with one another. It does not mean we all have to agree with each other, but it does mean that we must be careful to maintain the spirit of Christ in our precious blood-bought fellowship. And this is why I like to refer to the communion service as the hub of our fellowship. Everything moves out from this gathering. It's kind of like a temperature control. It guides us and leads us. It reminds us what we are all about. We are not simply a society or a social gathering. We are the bride of Christ. We are the body of Christ. We have been purchased. We belong to Jesus, and we need to be continually reminded through this coming together that indeed is the case. This is so important that Paul calls us to examine ourselves and then eat. So we don't want to be presumptuous. We don't want to go through ritual or routine. The last thing we want to do is partake in an unworthy manner like the Corinthians were behaving. And that really is what Paul is talking about. The way they were behaving was not becoming of those who named the name of Jesus. And so communion is an opportunity for an ongoing reset within the body of Christ, something which is continually required because of the trappings of the carnal nature and the sense we have to, and the proneness we have to leave the God we love. To ignore, take this lightly, has its consequences when we speak of the Lord's discipline in various forms. While we are commanded to come, we must first deal with our carnal behavior first. And so the scriptures teach us that this is an opportunity as we examine ourselves. Lord, is there something in my heart and my mind that is not right in my relationship with my brother or sister in Christ? Am I not loving them? Am I not putting them first? Am I saying things about them that simply isn't pleasing to you? Do I have a bitterness? Do I have a grudge? Are these things that are driving me? Am I being led by the flesh, or am I being led by the Spirit? Oh Lord, help me to love my brother and my sister. Help me to forgive as I am forgiven. I mean, this is an ongoing problem within church life. Paul tells Euodias and Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. Why? Because there were two women in the church that were going at it. And Paul is saying, no, don't you realize who's Lord in your lives and that you behave accordingly as God has poured his grace out upon you? So you need to be gracious to one another. Or as Paul says in Philippians 4:32, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. We love because Jesus first loved us. And the call of communion is that we love one another in response to loving Christ. Well, it's a real privilege to partake and to lead in this. This is something that is very solemn. It's very serious, and so we don't want to just simply go through a routine or a ritual and say, well, I've had communion. We want this to be a place of renewal, of connecting with our walk with Christ in terms of our fellowship with him. And so we will share the communion elements, and you're at home, and if you can simply gather some what I call Baptist wine, but some fruit of the vine and some bread, and then you can partake with us. And so I'm going to ask Derek if he could come and pray for concerning the broken body of Jesus Christ regarding the bread. Do you want to bring that with you?
Dear Lord, today we want to eat some bread, and we want to remember that you gave your body over to be shamed, over to be killed, and you also say that you are the bread of life, and that means you nourish us and feed us in our lives. These concepts, I'm sure none of us can actually understand the true significance. But I thank you, Lord, for doing this for us, and we would like to proclaim it and share in it today. Thank you.
the bread is being passed out to a few people that are here. We'll just take a moment, and then we will call for the breaking of bread. And Jesus took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Eat all of it in remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ." I'm going to ask Brother Mike Rosemary to come and give thanks for the shed blood of Jesus.
Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for Calvary and where you sent your Son to die for all our sins, and whose blood wipes away all the stains of iniquity, makes us pure again. And Lord, we thank you for that final sacrifice and complete sacrifice. And that, Lord, that was not done in vain, and Lord, never needs to be done again. So help us to remember this. Help us to live lives through thankfulness to you for the debt that we never could repay. And in Christ's precious name, amen.
And Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. Drink it in remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ." Remembering how his blood has washed away all our sin and our lives have now been purchased and belong to him. Lord Jesus, this simple ordinance that we practice is so powerful because it reminds us of what binds us together. It's the work of your Son, Father, on Calvary and all our behalf. So let us remember that we are yours, that we are blood-bought, and that we might be governed in our lives and in our relationships with one another and in the priorities of our lives by the work of Christ for us. Help us to be patient with one another. Help us to love one another, to remember what that love is, even when we struggle in our humanity with one another and have difficulties. Help us to be committed to this love regardless and overcome evil with good and bring pleasure to you, Father, because you delight when your brethren dwell together in unity. Help us, Lord, to be unified around this table and everything that is implied by what we have done here. Lord, encourage us, encourage this church. Encourage this church as they come together, as they seek your will for the future, that they might, Lord, be willing to give up their own personal agendas and put it all on the table. Say, Lord, what will you have us do? Help us, Lord, to understand that this church at Aberdeen belongs to you. It's blood-bought. It's purchased by you. You are its Lord. And we want to submit to you and behave as if it is. For we believe, Jesus, in your resurrection. We believe in your intercession on our behalf. And we believe, Jesus, that you are coming back to take us to be where you are. And we just pray that we would anticipate that and show it in the way that we live together as a Christian community. For it's in Jesus' name I pray, by his authority. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Brother John. Appreciate you being with us here today and helping us out in different things. And next week, Scott MacArthur, I believe, is going to be with us. He was on staff a number of years back at Aldergrove Fellowship Baptist Church, so he's going to be with us next week. So be praying for our people, and let's be praying for our deacons, leadership, and we just ask that you would... have a great week, and be sharing with others the good news that we have. Christ arose. Amen.